God, amen, amen.
Praise the Lord, amen, amen. Thank you, ushers, for taking up our offering, amen. Glory to God, praise the Lord, hallelujah. Welcome to Holiness and Common Ministry International. Glory to God for those who are listening in. Glory to God, hallelujah. If you're listening in by way of Blog Talk Radio, glory to God. If you're listening or looking in by way of our YouTube channel, glory to God. Welcome to Holiness and Empowerment Ministry International. Thank God for our services thus far. I am so refreshed in the presence of the Lord, in the company of the saints. Beauty of holiness, glory to God. Living out this lifestyle of wholeness, glory to God. In spirit, soul, and body, realizing that we have everything we need and that we're not lacking anything, glory to God. Say with me, I lack nothing. I lack nothing. I lack nothing. Glory to God. We just got to really take that by force and understand that wholeness is God's way. We are empowered by His Spirit, and thank God we are saved by His grace. And without the grace of God, we are nothing. Amen. We need His favor upon us. Glory to God. If ever you need anything, you need to know that you need God. You need God's favor. You need His approval, His stamp of approval upon your life. You need Him in everything you do and say. You need His breath to even breathe. My God, if only the wicked knew, hallelujah, what they're missing, glory to God. And that's why we're continuing to intercede and pray for them. But this morning we're continuing. We thank God for our theme on this year, maintaining focus, glory to God, as kingdom builders, glory to God. Understanding we can't allow anything, the cares of this life, the deceitfulness of this fleshly life, the cares of this world, or anything to hinder us from building the kingdom. Nothing comes before building the kingdom of God. If we can stick this Matthew 6:33 with everything that we have, with all our strength and energy, and stop making excuses, we can seek the kingdom like God has called us to seek it, and allow all those things that we need to come easy. I like the easy way. If Jesus say my way is easy, I want to seek Him first, glory to God. So all the things that I need, they can come through to me with the oil of God's favor upon them. And it is the oil of God that makes the favor of God available to those who are willing to seek His kingdom. Amen. This morning we're continuing in our URAP teaching series. As you know, this is the branding of Holiness Empowerment Ministry International. Understanding, receiving, and activating the power of God. Nobody can do this for me. I have to do this for myself. I got to understand this word. I got to receive this word. And I got to activate this word, this powerful word, by doing this word. And nobody can do this for me. I have to do this for myself. Something of just personal. Nobody can go to bathroom for you. Amen. Nobody can eat for you. Nobody can see for you. Glory to God. And definitely nobody can breathe for you. You got to understand that I got to inhale and exhale on my own. Glory to God. And so it is that way in your spiritual life. Hallelujah. So we're continuing in this wonderful book of Hebrews. In our last teaching, we were in the third chapter, glory to God. And I'm going to read those verses. I didn't read them last week, but I'm going to read them for the sake of bringing you up to where we are. I'm excited about this word and how good it is to me. Take it personal. How good it is to you. Amen? You can say that too. The 12th verse of that third chapter says, be careful then, dear brothers and sisters. Make sure that your own hearts are not evil and unbelieving, turning you away from the living God. You must warn each other every day while it is still today, so that none of you will be deceived by sin and harden against God. For if we are faithful to the end, trusting God just as firmly as when we first believed, we will share in all that belongs to Christ. Say with me, I will share in all that belongs to Christ.
I will share in all that belongs to Christ.
Remember what it says. Today when you hear his voice, don't harden your heart as Israel did when they rebelled. Glory to God, you got to fight against rebellion. You got to do whatever it takes to not allow anything to offend you. Because offense turns into offensive. To be offended is blatant rebellion. It's a form of rebellion. When you get offended by somebody, you turn quickly over into rebellion. And I believe it is because there is a residue of rebellion already there. Right. If you got a residue of rebellion, you rejecting against God, you're easily offended. Yeah. So you got to fight for what belongs to yours. You got to unify with this word and not allow the hardness of this life to cause you to kick against what God has said. Today you hear my voice, don't harden your heart. 16 verse said, who was it who rebelled against God? Was it you? No, right now it was them then, but some of us are rebellious today. Even though they heard it, boy, they heard what God say do. Wasn't it the people Moses led out of Egypt? And who made God anger for 40 years? Wasn't it the people who sinned, whose corpse laid in the wilderness, and to whom was God was speaking when he took an oath that they will never enter his rest? Glory to God. Wasn't it the people who disobeyed him? So we see that because of their unbelief, they were not able to enter his rest. And so this morning we're continuing in this subtitle, God's Rest of His Covenant, Part 5. We got to understand that this rest belongs to God. You can allow witchcraft, manipulation, a twisted, thwarted mind to make you try and change the way God sees things. His terms are very clear. What he wants is very clear. You don't have to try and guess it and figure out what God wants. He is clear with what he says. Thank God each of us speak English. And we don't come in here speaking Portuguese or Bangladesh or Patois and all this other language. Even though Patois is so much of English, amen, that we don't understand. But we clearly speak to each other just like God does. And so we can't play with it and say, I didn't quite understand what God is saying. In our last teaching, we went into the book of Mark about two Sundays ago. And we were talking about the rest of God and what it entails. And we saw that, we told you a couple weeks ago, way back, about how you enter God's rest by understanding you don't belong to yourself, you belong to Christ. And so we went and took an occasion to see what Jesus talked about when it came down to the temple of his time, which was a building. We understood that Jesus said, I don't dwell in any buildings any longer. No longer, that is not the way I do it. Now you are the temple of the Lord. So we took an occasion to see the metaphor of how Jesus see his temple. We saw him go into the temple and beat the money changers out, glory to God, and say, you make my house a den of thieves, and now my house is to be called a house of all prayer for all people, all nations. And so in that passage, we saw in an occasion where Jesus was on his way, before he went there to the temple to beat them out, he went through Bethany. He saw this fig tree. Amen. And all this goes together with that. It comes somewhat seem to be an oxymoron, but it goes together. And we saw where Jesus looked upon the fig tree, and he cuts the fig tree. And he said, no longer will you bear any more fruit. You won't take nobody else in disappointment. People, other folk, no longer you will be an imposter, a hypocrite, standing and looking like you could feed somebody. You can give somebody something. You ain't got nothing to give. You're done. And we said that anything that Jesus, well, it wasn't, we also said that it wasn't fig time. The scriptures clearly say that. It wasn't time for this poor little tree to bear fig. But we understood that this is not, the spiritual things is not predicated to times and seasons and seed time and it's a harvest time. It's not predicated to that. The word of God clearly stated, glory to God, that we are trees planted by the rivers of water who are enabled to bring forth fruit in season. Period. That's what it said. In season. And so we understand that season is a thing that don't have an occasion to just, well, there's not going to be any season. No, we have seasons all around in the natural. And so season is a timing of all times. It's a now time. This is the season that God is talking about. I need you to bear fruit in your favorable times, in your unfavorable times. I need you to be ready at all times. Because if I can't use you, anything God can't use is what barren it is considered a curse. And so we saw the example of Jesus actually cursing the seed tree. And then the disciples got excited and they walked back through that way and they say, look at that tree that the master curses is really dried up. It really did what he said. And so we took an occasion to let you know that you have the power to speak also. God has enabled you by his spirit to speak what will and would not be. And so Psalm 101 told us that, oh, the joys of those who don't follow. Why? Why can't we speak? Why our leaves won't wither? Why we are not cursed? We're not cursed because we don't enjoy the wicked standing in the ways of sinner. We don't enjoy sitting in the seat of the scorner. We said that we're too busy delighting in the law of the Lord. We're too busy meditating and bringing forth, glory to God, after God's fruit of righteousness, glory to God. And we understand that that includes the souls of men. It is not, we're not just saved for ourselves, but we're saved to save the unchurched, the lost. We are saved to bring glory to God by what? Bringing souls into the kingdom of God. And so we said that, go to me with me to Mark the 11th chapter. Glory to God. We don't have to be surprised like Peter was. Look, Rabbi, the tree you curse is withered. We know death and life is in the power of our tongue. You got to understand that you have a power that is inside of your mouth, your voice. Death and life is in the power of your tongue. The Bible says you will ultimately have whatsoever you say. Whatsoever you say is a byproduct of what's in your heart. And so that's what we're going to talk about this morning, your heart. Glory to God. We've been hearing that word from the time Elder began to pray up till now. Hallelujah. And so let's go back to this passages and see what Jesus continued to say to his disciples. They was getting excited. My master, can we talk like that? Can we speak? That tree did just what you told it to do. It's cursed. And so Jesus began to talk to them. He began to give them instructions. And so this is why we go to Bible study. We go to church to hear the word of the Lord. We study in the time of our daily devotion because we want the instructions of the Lord. It is the instructions of the Lord that enables us to be successful in all we do. Let's go to Mark 11 chapter, the 22nd verse. After Peter got excited, Jesus said to them, have faith in God, Peter. I tell you the truth, you can say to this mountain, may you be lifted up and thrown into the sea, and it will happen. But you must really believe it will happen and have no doubt in your heart. I want these words to stick to your soul. Amen. And I'm going to say it again. But you must really believe it will happen and have no doubt in your heart. Say with me, I can't afford doubt.
I can't afford
doubt. I can't afford to be in doubt.
I can't afford to be in doubt.
Because I can't afford to be without. Then he said the 24th verse, I tell you, you can pray for anything. We're still talking about God's rest. Yes. This is why we don't enter God's rest, because we don't get it like this. But we say with me, I'm going to get it like this.
I'm going to get it like this.
You can pray for anything. And if you believe you received it, it will be yours. But when you are praying, listen to these instructions. Oh,
God. Lord.
I was praying this morning.
Yes.
First, forgive anyone you holding a grudge against.
Yes.
God. So that your Father in heaven will forgive your sins too. And so if God, if Christ have these words simultaneously one after another speaking in this manner, he is saying something. There's an understanding that we need to get. Just Jesus took the moment to explain the word to them. So I as a leader can't take things for granted. And you as ministers can't take things for granted. We can no longer take people for granted. We need to really be detailed and practical and be ready to explain what is happening, what is going on. You must be a people of knowledge that want knowledge, love wisdom, have the ability and that hunger to want to word, want to know the truth. And so he took the moment, he explained to his disciples what was necessary for them to move in the same power that they saw him move in. Education of the word is what enables a willing heart. See, when if your heart is not educated, if you don't know some things, you're going to be obstinate. You're going to be hard. You're going to be oblivious to what is. But when you are willing and your heart is open, education, and you're a person that loves education, this is going to make you willing to have an open heart. The truth is going to make you free, like the word say. So first thing that we need that Jesus said is believe. He said that have faith in God. So this is something that all have the will to do. Why would Jesus tell you to have faith in someone or something that he has not enabled you to do it? Jesus would never offer he would never offer you today the opportunity to do something that you are not capable of. As we said in our leadership training on yesterday, God don't need folk that knows the word. He don't need folk that been through all this training. You got a ministerial license and you went to school all this time and you studied you're a theologian and you know all this stuff. He don't need none of that. I'm going to tell you what he needs. He only needs one thing. You to be willing. Because let me tell you something. You can think you got the word, but still ain't willing. You got nothing. When you got a willing heart with the word,
Amen. This
is what makes it work.
Right.
So you can't have the word without a willing heart.
Right.
You got nothing. So he would never tell us anything to do that he has not offered us the power to do. And so he said, have faith. Have faith. Faith, when someone tells you to have something, that is an invitation. They have now invited you into something. You know what I'm saying? Remember, when you got respect for something or somebody, you let them offer you. And he have invited us into this to receive what this enablement. I want you to have this enablement. When you take faith, take courage, take life, take joy, take peace, take this power, he said. Have means to take this faith by understanding it. Not only have faith, but I want you to understand this faith. And I'm going to tell you that I want you to understand. I want you to not only just understand it, but I want you to operate therein. Because the Bible said with all your getting, get an understanding. It is understanding that calls us to operate in what we know. So understanding the value of faith in God. And know that it will only work properly in a willing vessel. It only works when we are in Christ and Christ is in us. He said, if you abide in me and my word abide in you, you can ask what you will, and it shall be given in your time. Absolutely not. It's going to be given in his time. Why? Because we're always being proven. We're always being tested and tried by God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And so Jesus tells them in Matthew 17 and 20, jot this down. Jesus tells them in Matthew 17 and 20, have faith. He said, if you will have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you can say unto the mountain. They can do, you can be enabled to do what? Great explore. Meaning I'm going to move you, I'm going to show you how to move from the natural to the super. And therefore now you have been empowered and enabled to move from the natural to the what? Supernatural. So your faith is a privilege. The value of faith is our prosperity in God. Say with me, my faith is a privilege. And the value of my faith is my prosperity in God. See, you got to understand what you got here. And so this mustard seed, what are you doing with your mustard seed? You know, a mustard seed is so small that you can barely see it. Say, I only need a little bit. But see, the thing is, you can't say that I need a little bit and not be willing to develop that little bit. See, it's a little leaven that caused the whole lump to be destroyed. But it is your little faith that caused the perpetual growing up and a developing and a maturing of your faith, and therefore ushering you into what? Great faith. Your little faith should become great faith. Your faith should not stay the same. He's given us a mustard seed, glory to God. A God that has empowered us to what? Say, to speak. Remember everything God created. We started this flavor off. We went back to Genesis probably about four lessons ago. And we showed you where everything that God created, he spoke it into existence. So if we see the Father does it, if we see the Son do it, truly, we must be a people that are willing and able to eat the whole good of the land. Why? By speaking the word of God. However, we can't speak something that has not been rooted and grounded in us. Therefore, we become what? On that wrong side, we become a hypocrite. Saying one thing with a twisted mouth, but yet living contrary. And so you are empowered to ask what you will, the Bible say. He said, if I declare, I say to you, you have faith in God. You're able to have faith by being willing. And then you are, number two, you are enabled to speak. You can open your mouth and say to the hardest thing. You can say to death, behave. You can say to AIDS, behave. You can say to sickness and cancer and disease, behave in the name of Jesus. You can rise up in your sanctified self and open your mouth and tell lack no. You can say to the hard thing, the biggest thing, the greatest thing that is impossible to you has now become possible with God. Why? Because you've been given the authority of God. God has stamped his approval on you because why? Now you have faith. First, you got to get the faith before you're going to speak it. You got to know that where your faith got to be attached to. You can have faith in a lot of things. As we do in as human beings. Yes. But we got to have the right kind of faith. I need a faith in a God that cannot fail. I need a confidence and a trust that a God into a God that can do anything. The God of the divine nature. The God of a divine intervention. The God of the miraculous. The God that spoke and it was exactly what he said. You can't have faith in your soul and your mouth speaks contrary.
That's right.
Next he said, don't be thou finished. Be thou cast into the sea, you can say. Go. Well, you say, this don't make sense. How am I going to tell a mouth? How am I going to tell sickness to be cast into the sea? Well, how God say unto this mountain, get up mountain and go into the sea? I'm going to tell you, your little mind, your little finite mind will try and trick you. You know why? Because this nature that we live in, it is predicated upon the natural, what it can see, what it can taste. It is closely attached to these five senses we have. If I can't smell it, there's nothing there. If I can't see it, it's not there. If I don't hear it, nothing has been spoken. If I don't touch it, if I can't touch it, if I can't feel it, it's not there. But we must be a people that understand, I got to transition my soul. I got to transition my ability to know that God's word is right. I can't allow the consciousness of my natural taste, touch, smell to be the byproduct of my belief system. But I got to understand just that there is consciousness, there is unconsciousness. There is what is called a subconscious. Subconscious is that which you are not aware that is going on in the background. And so therefore the Bible says, I'm getting ahead of myself. You got to understand that I can't allow doubt to take me out.
Right.
Say with me, I can't allow doubt to take me out. Number three, he said, first have faith, and then he said, speak. And then he said, and have not doubt in your heart. And so you cannot walk in faith and doubt at the same time. Light and darkness don't go together. If we shut the light off in this room, it will be dark in here. Some things just don't work together. Oil and water don't mix. So when you believe God and you receive it by faith, then you can ask God and know that he has heard your request. He said, if you being evil know how to give your children what they need, how much more would I give them that ask my children? And so therefore you go to God in peace knowing that what he answers in his time. So I cannot let doubt to take me out. Doubt is acid to my faith. Say with me, doubt is acid to my faith. Doubt is acid to my faith. And so doubt acts out in the subconsciousness of the man's mind. And things that you are not aware of, you got to snap out of everything that will cause you to put your head in the sand and not realize what's going on in your back office. See, by way of back office, I mean these subliminal ways that the devil is just so ironic how Mr. Baby's not feeling well today. She texted me the other day and asked me about the subconscious mind and how the subconscious work and stuff like that. But you got to understand that there are some things working in the back office of life.
Amen.
And so this thing works through not only your nature, but it also works through people.
Yes.
The closest people to you will be your worstest enemy if you allow their doubt to be sprayed upon you. It's like a skunk that sprays somebody. Husbands spray wives and wives spray husbands. And allow your unconscious, your subconscious to pick this junk up and you wonder what's wrong with you. You got to understand how to deal with people. When people are outside of your sphere of influence of that you want, you got to tell them, you know what, I don't want to hear that.
Amen.
I don't even hear that. I'm not going to even allow you to plant that in my ears.
Right.
If you don't speak against it, it rests in your subconscious. It works subliminally in a way where you don't even understand. Well, I ain't got nothing to say.
Yeah.
Well, if you don't say nothing, you got to say it in your mind. I'm the blood of Jesus over my mind. I don't see that. The blood, the blood, the blood. You murmuring and complaining and talking about folk, let them talk. And sometimes you can't shut them up. They'll say the blood of Jesus. But you can remove yourself out of the atmosphere. Oh, hallelujah. Just start shouting. Start giving God the glory. Amen. Start giving him praise. Why? Because I don't want to hear that. I can't afford to be without faith. This doubt that's subliminally trying to take me out. I can't allow it to work against my focus in being a kingdom builder. I got to know that what I got is great. And God has made me the captain of the ship of my soul. I'm in control. You want to be in charge? Be in charge of your own self. Lead yourself in this thing the right way. God say, I call you to lead. I've given you everything that pertains. Lead, child. Lead. You ain't got to wait for me. Lead. I have enabled you. You're already in power. Say unto the mountain, you say it. You say it. Well, Master, we want you to say it. Like the prophet Ezekiel, the Lord asked, can these bones live? The Lord wanted to see what this prophet going to say, this mighty man. Then he going to tell the Lord, Lord, you know. God said, open your mouth, prophesy, speak to the mountain, say, to the not. Be thou removed. I'm not dealing with lack anymore. I'm not dealing with sickness. I'm not dealing with obesity anymore. I'm not dealing with hatred. I'm not dealing with depression and strife and suicidal thought and contentiousness and argumental thoughts and the promiscuity and lust and hatred and jealousy and strife and weariness and rebelliousness and all these enemies. I'm not dealing with them anymore. Get out of here, devil. You got done. See, you're going to have one or the other. Faith or doubt. You see, it ain't no such thing as, oh, I'm going to have both today. Well, today I'm in faith, and I believe in God. But tomorrow you went down. They do not work together. Holy things of God. See, this faith that we have, it was given to us by God. It belongs to God, but you take ownership of it. See, you can allow the seed, the muscle seed of faith to be stunted and don't grow, or you can allow it to grow up to be what? A big tree. It grew up to be one of the biggest trees, the strongest, the shadiest tree of them all.
Glory to God.
So you have got to deal with your doubt by letting the axe of the word cut this thing down. Say with me, I got to let the axe of the word cut this neck of doubt off.
I
got to
allow the axe of the word to cut this neck of doubt off.
See, lastly, number four, Jesus said to them, forgive everyone that offended you or that you are holding a grudge. Many times people are mad not just at other people. They are mad and holding a grudge against God. Well, God, you didn't answer me. God, you see me over here. You see I'm suffering. God say, and? Shall I show you how my son suffered for your behind? And you're whining because of them 2 pennies you lost. See, you can't be forgiven by God until you what? Forgive. You got to be the first one to forgive before you can be forgiven. Say with me, some things just come first. And you can't flip that around. You could try all you want, but you can't. Unforgiveness shut you out of the rest of God. You see people can't rest? You see, they can't grab hold to this word. You know why? Because many times they are holding a grudge. See, a grudge is like a hatchet. It's like an axe in your back. You know, it's hit your dead center down your spine. Unforgiveness is. And it keeps you from standing up straight. It keeps you from walking upright. Instead, you're walking crooked. Why? Because you got an axe of unforgiveness in your back. And until you get that axe out by giving up the ghost, giving up that lie, that they don't like me, you holding a grudge, and them people ain't even thinking about you that way. It hasn't even happened that way. You just allow your nasty self to lead you. And then you go share that mess with somebody else. Yeah, you know what they say. Yes, sir, you know them. Husbands, when your wives run their mouth too much, tell them, can you shut up? She talking junk, tell her to shut up. Be quiet. You talking too much junk. Go the other way too. Wives, help your brother out. Help your husband out. Help the brother out. When he talking too much junk, could you please be quiet? Shut up. And like God told Abraham, listen to your wife Sarah. Right now is what she said is what you need.
Jesus.
See, there's no opportunity to see the mighty hands of God until we enter the rest of God. You can't see the mighty hand of God unless you are resting in him. You don't see nothing. You be like, oh, they all excited. I don't see nothing.
Wow.
That's because your outside looking in. See, we're going to learn in a couple of weeks how big this faith is that we got. Say with me. You're going to learn how big this faith is I got. Say it to your neighbor. And see, that don't shut them right up. When you get excited and they looking at you like, ain't nothing going on over there.
gonna learn that I ain't moved by what I see. I'm moved by what I say. And God, the privilege to manifest what I say in His time. Say with me, I'm ready to wait on God. That's His privilege. It is His privilege to do it whenever He get ready. So I wait in joy. I wait in praise. I wait with a mindset that is done, done. Nothing is done, done, and there's nothing else to say about it. There's no crying about it. There's no excusing anybody about it. That thing is good, is done. And so the heart must believe, Jesus told them, and not allow doubt to have a what? Foothold. See, there's what called a toehold, where you let a little bit of sin get in and kill you dead. And then there's a foothold where you're done. See, we can't operate in this rest with even a little toehold. Why? Because we know that a little leaven, as we say, leaveth the whole lump. And so the heart must believe God. There is an enemy of the heart that you can't afford to allow to take you out. This enemy of the heart, you can't afford to be oblivious of. We must be ready to look into this word to see what this enemy is. And be ready to fight the good fight of faith. This enemy worked hard as hell to take you out. And this enemy is very strategic. We know it's the devil. We know it's the self. We know it's the world. But we got something so much greater. As the Bible says, where sin abound, grace much more abound. And that grace don't much more abound to willful sin. Because He resists the proud and gives His grace to what? Those who humble themselves. How does this enemy work? Go with me, Jeremiah 17. This thief works as a result of the condition of your heart. So you have to work at the conditioning of your heart. See, we condition our hair. We want to make sure we deal with all these split ends. And we want to deal with this weakness and this damage in our hair. And make sure we have strong hair. We condition our bodies. Some people strength train and they condition their muscles. They condition, some people condition their mind to be as strong and be as best that they can be. And whatever they do, some people condition their thought pattern to be able to be able to great manipulator or great debater. Yes. They condition themselves with long, strenuous hours and they work hard at fighting and being the best champion they can be. Why? They watch their opponent. They see how they do it and they beat them at their own game. It's a wise man that get this word. We know the word, the source of our conditioning must be the word of God. The source of our conditioning, the source of this heart transplant. We need a new heart. Amen. The Bible talks about. Amen. What is the heart of man? Your heart is the central location of your being. Let's see what God has to say about our heart and how your heart can be a doubting heart. How your heart can be a heart that is a heart of dishonesty, a heart of cheating heart, a lying heart, a heart that is so rooted and raw in flesh that it will literally snuff you out of even chance of being saved. If you don't get this right, you cannot be saved. I'm so sorry to tell you that. Say with me, I must get this word. Ninth verse, Jeremiah 17. The human heart is the most deceitful of all things and desperately wicked. Who really knows how bad it is? But But I, the Lord, search all hearts and examine secret motives. I give all people their due reward according to what their actions deserve. And so we see here in the Word of God, the God that created man in his image and likeness, the God that took dirt and formed us and made our heart, the God that made your lung, that made every part of you, call your heart wicked as a human being. Say with me, I got a wicked heart. And it must be dealt with. See, without the Holy Spirit coming upon the man's heart, which is his spirit, he is wicked. The subconscious works in the midst of the man's heart. The subconscious could be an enemy to the man's heart if you pick up the wrong thing. If you have not had a transplant from the Holy Ghost, you need one. There are many in the church today who have not had a heart transplant. Some of them are preachers. Some of them are leaders, have churches. Some of them have titles. Some of them have been ushering and serving in the church for 40 years, and they've never been saved. They never had a heart transplant. And I am going to give you proof. Jesus said, many will say to him, Lord, Lord, we cast out devils in your name. We did this. Jesus said, I don't know you. I never knew you. Sitting in the church house, attending service, even serving in the church, is never the power behind our salvation. What empowers you to change is the ability to enter this rest. If you don't enter this rest of God, you're not saved. And let me break this rest of God down for you. The rest of God means that all my strength, all my energy is exhausted. As if that child is right there sleeping on the front row. She sleeps. All her energy, the strength of her legs and her bones and her muscles, everything is exhausted. Everything is literally shut down. When you are asleep, you are close to death. This is why some people sleep away. Their hearts stop beating. And the final exhaustion of that human anatomy is basically depleted and done. And so if her dad come and pick this child up, all her strength and everything is in his hand. Now all of her is resting in him. Her energy, her strength, why is sleeping? Everything is shut down. Her thoughts are even shut down. Yes. Right. Nothing is moving or happening. Yes. She just... To enter God's rest, meaning you, all of you, is exhausted. Yes. Meaning every part that you think that you deserve, everything that you think that what I deserve, I have a right, every right that self thinks it has. Because I'm going to tell you, it is you, it is the self in you, it is this nature in you that thinks that you have a right.
Yes, it does.
I'm entitled, God. No, you're not. You're only entitled except you're in Christ. He said, if you abide in me and my word abide in you, then you can ask. Say with me, then I can ask.
Yeah.
When my strength is exhausted.
My strength is exhausted.
This is why the word of God is saying, man, extremity, man, weakness is God's opportunity. When you come to the end of self and you give up the ghost, as Elder said this morning, you give up all your strength. Your ghost is your spirit. It is your heart. It is the real you.
Amen.
Say with me, I need a heart transplant.
I need a heart transplant.
So all the issues of our life, according to Proverbs 20. Well, that's not the scripture, Proverbs 20 and 27. But the Bible talks about guard your heart, for there, I probably got it down further. The issues of life, every part of you stems from the heart. That's why I say the heart is the central part of the man. Proverbs 20, 27 says, the Lord's light penetrates the human spirit, exposing every hidden motive. You can't hide from God. Okay, I'll slick you in. You can be slick as red. Yeah. Slick as butter, slide, slick as glue. You think you greasy and got it all together? I'm slick, ain't nobody see me. Really? See, the people that don't see you don't matter. The one that matters sees me. Say with me, the one that matters sees me. The one that matters hears me. The one that matters knows me. And I know him. What a privilege to know him. What a privilege to walk into everything that you know. Meaning you're not trying to perpetrate something. You're not trying to be something you're not. But you just are his child. And you belong to him. You can sing that song with the surety of faith, without doubt. I belong to him. Why? Because I see the fruit of what I belong to. I'm not walking in my mama's daddy's DNA with that nasty attitude and trying to get away with it. You may belong to Jesus and cuss and vote out. It don't work that way. So your human spirit is your heart. This is why you must properly give your whole heart. He said, love the Lord with all your heart, your life, your strength, your motives, your intentions, and every part of you. Love him with your all. People can say they're giving their heart to God, but without the evidence, they are not telling the truth. And you can hold them accountable. See, you'll know when you enter God's rest, your old self is no longer a factor that you answer. It no longer can talk to you. Why? Because dead people don't talk. See, people that are alive don't entertain dead things.
That's right.
You want to go over there to that hill with them buzzards? Why you got it? Why you droning them buzzards? Why you droning the sin? There's some deadness there. When residue is there, you're drawn to it. And you go back like a dog turned to his vomit. How can I know that I entered his rest? I repel and I loathe dead things.
My God.
You learn to loathe sin, which means to hate it.
Wow.
And you learn to loathe lying. A cheating heart? No, I ain't finna cheat. So after a man gives his heart to God, you're a new creature. Your old self is no longer a controlling factor driving your car, your truck, your motorcycle. No longer is it driving your bicycle, taking you through those shortcuts and those habits where you think people don't see you. But yet you know that I'm driving this life in the Holy Ghost. Why? Because I'm partnered with God. This is why Paul said, no longer I, but Christ that lives in me. But you need to remember the I, so you cannot think that God gonna do everything, or other people gonna do everything for you. You better go pray to God for yourself. You better read and see God for yourself, baby. Baby, you might be young, but you need to seek God. Say with me, I need to seek God. No matter how cute I am. No matter how young I am. No matter how old I am. No matter how much I think I know. I need to seek God.
I need to seek God.
That's the truth.
So the old has come. The old has gone and the new has come.
But you need to know that there's some work to be done. Proverbs always talk about hard work, people that are willing to work. But God said, if I work hard, I won't be in poverty. You think God talking about you go out there and neglect his services and go out there and make your little pennies? That ain't what he talking about. People use that as an excuse. God say hard work, so I got to go double time, go to go make the donuts. Work hard is a form of wholeness, all well-rounded. Work hard at your family. Work hard at pleasing your wife. Work hard at pleasing your children and your husband. Work hard at your relationship. Work hard at getting along with your sisters and brothers in Christ. Work hard at working with leadership so that my job won't be grievous. So I won't do like Jesus. Jesus, I don't know them people. I thought they were going to do what you say do. But look like they ain't. So God let me know, if I had to say I don't know you, you might have to say you don't know them people. You know why? Because there are times I have to tell myself I don't know you and I'm not going to do that.
That's right.
You ain't know that. So not only am I looking outward inwardly, but I'm looking outwardly. And I'm looking inwardly again. I got to know that I got to check myself before I wreck myself. Have you obtained yet? Have I obtained?
No.
We press towards the mark. I don't have two heads and I ain't crazy. But I got to understand that I got to press because I know this heart of mine could be tainted at any time if I choose to slack up on God. See, slack people always got an excuse for their lack. Because they what? Who going to get that? Because they doing what?
Oh, thank you.
They too busy snatching. I thought a couple of y'all going to get that together. So there must be some work. Go with me here. We're drawing close. Proverbs 4:20. Go with me. There's some work that I got to do. And there's some work that you got to do. And every man, I got to work and you got to work. All God's children got to work to do. When we get to heaven, we're going to know that we just slide in with nothing to do. We're going to know that I worked my soul salvation with fear and trembling before the Lord. This word specifically is telling us to guard our heart. Let's go there. All things flow from the heart, from your spirit, your human spirit, good or bad or ugly. 21st say, my child, pay attention to what I say. Listen carefully to my words. Don't lose sight of them. Let them penetrate deep into your heart. Say that with me. Let them penetrate deep within my heart. For they bring life to those who find them and healing to their what? Whole body. You think God wants your mind all wrecked up? Or your body all wrecked up? Or your mind wrecked up and your body look good? You look healthy, but your mind wrecked. Say with me, that's a problem. I need my whole body healed. I need my whole marriage healed. I need my whole family healed. I need my household healed. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Say with me, I need wholeness. 23rd verse. Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. Avoid all perverse talk. Stay away from corrupt speech. Look straight ahead and fix your eyes on what lies before you. Mark out a straight path for your feet. Stay on the same path. Say with me, the same path is obeying God.
The same path is obeying God.
Don't get sidetracked. Keep your feet from falling evil. Anytime you don't obey God or obey those who have rule over you, you are out of order. You're disobedient. Pretty much. All these officers tell you, walk over there. You tell them, hey, walk over there. You'll tell me what to do. Out of order. Your boss tell you to walk over there, and you walk over there and hurry. When you want me to walk again, you want me to pick you up, boss? What else you want me to do? That's why you work your finger a little to the bone for the little pennies. And God won't cause your labor to be easy. You won't even get your raise because you ain't got your perspective in the right place. You got to put things in the right perspective. Your business ain't more important than God's business. Say with me, my business ain't more important than God's business. If I can't seek the kingdom first, I don't deserve the things to be added to me. I hear y'all, that sounds so mean. But that's the word. And you know, people play with everything. And then, you know what? See, people don't play with some things that they like and attach to their heart, but they play with this word. You think you're so cute in your spot. Oh, I ain't got to seek the kingdom first. God ain't talking to me, really? He's talking directly to you. I got to seek him with my whole heart. Because the issues of life is flowing from my heart. Yes. And I can't hide from him. Yeah, right. He said, fix your eyes. So these are the instructions of the Lord. When we falter on following God's instruction, we falter on entering his rest. When you falter on entering his rest, there is no faith to develop. See, your faith don't develop. It's like a butterfly in a cocoon. Did I say that right? A caterpillar? In a cocoon. So if he didn't have that shell to transform him the way God made it to be, he ain't going to come out right. Put your cake outside. Or put your cake in your bathtub. Talk about you baking a cake. Got an oven. And that oven work real good. I'm putting this cake in the bathtub. Say with me, that's retarded. You know, people do their spiritual life just that way and expect things to work out right. The definition of insanity is doing the same old stupid thing spiritually and expecting God to move for you. God said, you ain't even in my rest. What you talking about? I don't see you in here. Where are you, Adam? Adam said, I'm over here with these little fig leaves. Don't you see me? I'm trying to hide under this money. I'm hiding under lust. I'm hiding under jealousy. Hiding under offense. I'm hiding over promiscuity. I'm hiding, God. I'm hiding under rejection. Hiding under rebelliousness. Don't you see me, God? I would come out, but I'm hiding. When you don't recognize that you got some issues and you ain't willing to deal with it like this woman that got low, you ain't entering his rest. It took a press in her mess to get to the rest. Say with me, it took a press in my mess to get to my rest.
It's gonna take a press in my mess to get to my rest.
These instructions. Sin is the culprit to these instructions being carried out. Unbelief, anxiety, dishonesty, disobedience. All these enemies shut faith down. And what it does is it intensifies doubt. These enemies are what works in your subconscious. You know why? Because subconscious work, you do it without thinking about it. Yep. Other folks see you doing it and you don't realize what you're doing.
That's the truth.
Yep. I ain't do that.
That's so true.
Oh, yes, you did. I ain't roll my eyes. I ain't rebellious. Yes, you are. I'm not disobedient. well, where you was when Pastor called for all the ministers to come and pray for them people. Like, I had to go there and get me something to eat. I was hungry. Jesus said, I was hungry and you ain't fed me. Naked and you ain't clothed me. You were too busy clothing yourself. See, this is the difference between busy standing in the way of sinners and being busy doing God's bidding. There's a difference. We're almost there. You got to guard your heart, your spirit, and its condition. This is your responsibility. It is your responsibility to take care of your two-month-old baby. What you doing? Oh, I'm going to the club, the baby home. Girl, what a baby. The baby home. Where's she going? Where's that mother going? Nobody don't know where this mother going. She's going to jail. You take your faith to jail in lockup. Because you don't take care of your responsibilities of something tender at your heart. Wow. Sometimes you got to close your eyes and ooh. Okay.
Amen.
Cover your nakedness.
Amen.
If you are spiritually lazy and make excuses for carnal things before spiritual things, you're not going to get this. What happens to people that make excuses for carnal things, for spiritual things, they cause frustration in their whole life and wonder why they can't stop? Not only do you frustrate your life and you start doubting God, but then you begin to frustrate each other. This is why many marriages don't work. People aren't doing their homework. You can't sit under this word and expect not to be accountable. God said, I want to respond from this word that I'm getting you.
That's right.
I'm telling y'all, holiness, you're going to be held in deep accountability than them folk that hearing them mammy pads of gospel.
Amen.
Some people hear the same thing every Sunday.
Amen.
I was talking about yesterday what to do. But when you get such a word that is full of instructions, I got to react to what I heard. Well, other folk will start saying, baby, you've been hearing the word.
That's true. Amen.
They'll start telling you, you've been hearing the word. Oh, yeah. I see it on you. I see it on you. There's a glow. You've been hearing the word. I see you doing it. I see you different. You got to get so different till your spouse don't know you no more. I mean, when your spouse ain't right with God, they don't know you no more. But when you learn to grow together, you complement each other.
Amen.
And you work like syrup is the pancake. They go together. Our relationship is supposed to go together. We supposed to be sweet to one another. We supposed to be getting along. This is the rest of God. Don't you want your marriage to go into the rest?
Amen.
Stop fighting and biting and devouring one another, kicking. He kicked us, he kicked them. The man was kicking each other. Y'all ever seen that movie where Mrs. and Mrs. Angelina Jolie and her husband played? Mrs. and Mrs. Smith. It happened like that spiritually. You just fighting up something. Slapping each other. I'm like, how could be two people and next minute they love it up? I'm like, oh, Jesus. So we got to, it's time to grow up and stop acting like the world. It's time for us to stop being worldly. This word says to avoid all perverse talk. You at your job talking all kind of junk and wonder why you can't enter God's rest and your faith won't develop. You kicking the breeze and let your hair that you ain't even got on your head die. And you just getting on in it. You just done went deep up under it. And they not even looking up. Man, I ain't know you go that deep. I thought you was in the church. Well, bro, I can get down with junk talking. You got to avoid perverse talk and corrupt speech. Remember, I don't have time to stand in the way of sinner. Why? Because I'm building on something. My faith can't be corrupt. I got to enter the rest of God. And I got to enter it now. Then it says, look ahead and fix your thoughts on what lies before you. You got to move your eyes from that crooked, white, lying, cheating way that's telling on you. That cheating heart that's telling on you. Fix your eyes. Move your eyes from the cheating way. Stop lying to people. Amen. Stop trying to fool people. Turn your eyes away from that and fix your eyes on this word that is righteous. You got to make your crooked way straight. God has given us everything to do this. The word says it. Everything that pertains to godliness, we've got it. Say with me, I've got it. I just got to use it. See, your spouse can't use it for you. Your children can't use it. Your parents can't use it for you. Your best friend can't use it for you. Your neighbor, your pastor can't use it for you. The elder, the prophet, the evangelist, the teacher, the minister, the praise team. Nobody can use it. You got to do it. I'm going to read this last verse, and I'm going to let you know. It does not matter how we try and act, as if we didn't understand or didn't know. This word and the God that created us knows everything. Proverbs 24:12. I'm going to stop right. It says, don't excuse yourself by saying, look, we didn't know. For God understands all hearts, and he sees you. He who guards your soul knows you knew. He will repay all people as their action deserves. Say with me, if I'm going to play with it, God going to expose me to his servants just like that. If God know you're cheating and you're lying, and you knew what you were supposed to be doing, the people of God knows. There's an old saying, go, you can fool some of the people some of the time, but you can't fool all the people none of the time. See, you can fool some people, though some people are people that are ignorant, that have their head in the sand, but you cannot fool all the people all the time. This is a challenge for us to get rid of our hypocrisy. Stop playing with God and enter the rest so we can win souls. So the power of God's spirit can come back into the church. And I'm not talking about a powerful service. Didn't we have a powerful service? They were all over the floor. That is not it. I'm tired of that anyway. Let me see you live holy. Let me see you get off your drugs and your promiscuity and stop lying. Let me see you rise up and preach this gospel in a holy lifestyle that you live every day, even in unfavorable times when you have an excuse to go shipwreck on the gospel. You stand still.
Oh, Lord.
That's what pleases God. That's what pleases God. We got to rise up so we can fill the house of the Lord. We can fill this nation with souls, people that are coming up and testifying. Not that man of fans and testify where they testify one thing and do another. Well, you can look at it and say, baby, you schizophrenic. You double-minded. Now, you got over some things, but there are many more to come. Are you willing to sit under this strenuous word and be healed, whole? The right way? You can't be healed if you're all over the place. You got to enter God's rest and stay there. Stay there. When we enter God's rest, we're just like Psalms 1:1. He is like that tree planted by the rivers of water, yielding his fruit in season. whatsoever he put his hand to prosper. This is not about one, two people, three people getting this. This is about the body of Christ corporately getting this. You see why I preach not just the wholeness. I want to preach this word to anybody I got a voice to. If I could shepherd, if I could disciple a nation of people, I would. I'd stand right on a rock like Moses did and talk to all the thousands of people. I know the word of the Lord is in my mouth. And it's valuable. That ain't pride. I want people to change. Because I'm sick of hypocrisy. I hate fake people. I don't hate them, but I hate the spirit. Like God does. It is time for us to rise up, stand to your feet. It is time for us to get passionate about God. While the devil is constantly taking people to hell every day, people are dying. They're dying in the hospital. They're dying on the streets. And we're right here playing a church. This is the time where God is going to pull the covers. And people that are think they're on the pinnacle, God is going to strip them so everybody can see their nakedness. Some, this shame will cause them to be healed, fall prostrate, and really get saved. And some will get even weaker. We must keep praying. We must keep believing God. We are the solution to God in the earth for people. You got to see yourself as a solution. You got to see yourself. My work in the Lord is important. It's vital. If I'm not in church, if I'm not on post, then somebody might, God might want to do something and I'm not in place. I shipwrecked the whole thing because I'm like, so well, you know, I got to get my hand up. God say, guard your heart. When your heart is guarded and you have the Spirit of the Lord over your heart, nothing comes before you. Nothing. And don't get this twisted. God is not talking about you every point. I'm on point. I'm on point. You get religious and routine. This is not talking about religious and routine. This is talking about a heart of God. When that heart is right, it's like, no, my heart is telling me I need to. Then you connect with the other saints and say, girl, your heart sure told you right. I love moments like that when I follow my heart because God moves me that way. And you run into it and you say, oh, man. See, many times if you don't judge right and make the right decision, I'm gonna explain it to the best to my ability. It's like an appointment, an appointed time. The person that needed what you had missed it because you wasn't there. And that's in every given situation. Not just in church, on your job, in your neighborhood. You were supposed to be there on the spot, but you decided to go that way. That's why he said, acknowledge God in all your ways. Sometimes he'll speak to your heart, and you say, I'm going to the market now. Your heart will say, don't go to the market right now. Mm-hmm. Instead, go over to the Auntie Joe's house. And just where you showed up, the people that needed to see you, and you needed to, that you needed to say, they needed to hear. I'm talking about divine appointments. That's what it's all about. Guarding your heart. Resting in God. Knowing that what God is speaking to your heart, it is right. And he will never lead you wrong. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for the word. Father, we thank you that your word is forever settled in heaven and in earth. And it is your word that is the vital resource that we need on today. We thank you, Father, that your spirit partners with your word. And because we are full of your spirit, it is the word of God that becomes alive to us and quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. Help our unbelief by giving us the power and the fire and the passion to rise up and do our due diligence to get this word in our ear and allow it to penetrate our heart that we might not sin against you. Help us to know that we are under the secret place when we have evidence of that secret place by faith. And it is not a faith that is of the things of this world, but it is a faith that is sure. We thank you, Father, that we can do this. Every soul in the sound of my voice, I pray that the word of God would go in and sever every soul tie, expose those subliminal ways of our subconscious lifestyle that are hidden from us and that we think that is okay with you, Father. Don't let us sleep. Don't let us rest comfortably. But, Father, deal with our madness. Stir up the righteous indignation and move us from this place of sleeping and slumbering over the things that you've called us to put our hands to. We need you, God. We thank you that faith has enabled us to receive from you. And no matter what we have to go through to get there, we pray that every soul would get there. And that none would be lost. None would be in lack. None will be in want. Why? Because you are our shepherd and we don't have to want for anything. We prophesy over our lives that you make us to lie down in green pastures. We choose to lie down beside the still waters. We choose to allow your rest to restore our souls daily. We drink from the brook of life, fresh water, water that is plenteous, water that is flowing, water that is real and healing our issue and making us whole so we can in turn touch the lives of the weary, the lives of the lost, the unchurched, the bruised, the broken. Father, we thank you, Lord, that we are unbroken people, we are unshakable people, that you have healed us, that we know what it means to be broken over sin and the things that bruise your heart. We thank you, Father, that we're able to get this. We thank you for our daily bread. You're feeding us every day. And you're causing us to grow up that we're no longer the same. We thank you and we praise you for every family in this building on this morning. We thank you for healing every family, delivering every family. We thank you that the strong of the family is bearing the infirmity of the weak. And we're bearing the infirmity by praying for our loved ones. We're not so lazy that we won't rise up and pray. We thank you, God, that we're rising up to prayer and intercession. We're rising up to fasting. We're rising up to turning the other cheek. We're rising to fix our eyes on the things that matter, the things that are pure, the things that are loving. We're rising up and prophesying the proclamation of the word, and we're letting the word go ahead of us so that we won't live lives that are frustrated. We thank you, Lord, that we can do this and our lives are working because of you. We love you. We praise you in your Son, Jesus' name alone. Amen. Amen. There is a river that never shall run dry. Glory to God. Hallelujah. somebody trying to sabotage her school. And hire a hitman to destroy her. Is she saved, the owner of the school? But well, we know it only takes one to stand in the gap to cause every plan and every trap, every snare and assignment of the devil to be totally rerouted. We call it back to them in the name of Jesus. We plead the blood of Jesus over your life, Lord of God, over Genesis' life. You're already covered over this school in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you that your angels are more than enough angels, the protections, angels that are healing this individual that is doing these threats right now in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, Father, that your faith is alive and well, glory to God, in your daughter, and that she's standing up even in the midst when that phone rang. She prophesied, devil, I command you to stop it right now in the name of Jesus. We agree with her. We come into oneness with her in the mighty name of Jesus. We declare that these threats shall stop. And then there will never be any carrying out to these threats to fruition. We declare it right now in the name of Jesus. We call that place safety. We call every child safe. We call every child whole and saved. We speak life over this owner, glory to God. If she's Jewish, glory to God, we pray that she will come to know a Yeshua HaMashiach. And we understand what the word of God says. You will write the word of God upon the table of Israel's heart. And no one needs to teach you. Not even the young ones will need to be taught that you, oh God, will do this according to your own will, according to your own word. We thank you that healing is now, protection is now, safety is now, that they are in the secret place and that the enemy can't find them in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, from ambushing the enemy. Oh God, releasing totally confusion over him. Right now, in the name of Jesus, we declare that this place is safe by the blood of the Lamb. You are the direct contact, glory to God. Now, I don't know if you're doing this, but when you go on your job, you pray, plead the blood. Yes, plead the blood. Walk around all over the territory. Speak in tongues. You do know how to speak in tongues, don't you? You never release your tongue. You never release your tongue. You don't know. You just haven't been using it. You need to open your mouth and pray. This is your assignment. See, we pray and we believe God. And we know God is already answering. But sometimes there's a requirement to go further. This could be a part of your training. I don't know what God is doing. I'm sure he is. But God wants you to pray in that building. Walk around there and pray. Pray through your day, just like you go there, you have a moment of, as a teacher, you make your own plans. Let there be a plan of prayer. He's going to release you and show you how to do it, how to pray. But I see you doing it and obeying God. Thank God for the testimony coming forth. Amen. We believe it's done. As you obey God, so shall it be. Amen. Nothing will hinder you from carrying out this assignment, amen?
Amen.
And we should pray on our jobs, wherever we go. We should pray around our neighborhood, in our homes, glory to God. We should always.